The Lord be with you. Good morning and a very warm welcome to our Harvest Festival Mass this morning at St. Michael's. Today we give thanks for all the good gifts that God gives us in his bountiful harvest. The harvest reminds us that all good gifts come from above. It is God who causes the earth to provide all that sustains life. So as we give thanks for the harvest, let us open our hands as well as our hearts. May the abundance we have received from God be shared with others, and may this set the seeds of faith we have been given bear fruit in lives of compassion, justice, and peace. And so, my brothers and sisters, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all.
Thank you. whom he has taken by his right hand, to subdue nations before him, and strip the loins of kings, to force gateways before him, that their gates be closed no more. It is for the sake of my servant Jacob of Israel, my chosen one, that I have called you by your name, conferring a title, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, unrivaled. There is no other God beside me. Though you do not know me, I arm you that men may know from the rising to the setting of the sun that, apart from me, all is nothing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
I speak in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Two men were walking through a field one day when they spotted an enraged bull. Instantly, they ran toward the nearest fence. The storming bull gave quick chase, and it soon became obvious they weren't going to make it to the fence in time. Terrified, the one shouted to the other, "Say a prayer, John, we're in for it." John answered, "I can't. I've never said a prayer out loud in my life." "But you must," begged his friend. "The bull is catching up to us quickly." "All right," panted John. "But I'll have to say the only prayer I know, the one my family used to repeat at the table," he said. "O Lord, for what we are about to receive, make us truly thankful." In our parable of today, we see many things which remind us of the dangers of wealth. You see, the rich who we hear about in the parable from today, which would have been the 28th Sunday in ordinary time, the parable goes that the rich man has many, many stores of grain. And he ends up having more and more grain. And so he asks himself, "What should I do with all this grain? I have too much grain and not enough storage." "I know," he says. "I will build bigger stores for my grain so that I have more grain, and I know then I will be safe and secure." The rich man has a huge harvest, but he doesn't see it as an opportunity to lower his price and feed the poor. His mind turns rather to building bigger stores where he can keep the grain for himself. Of course, this would amass for him a greater fortune. It would also ensure that there wasn't quite enough grain around, and therefore would continue to drive up the market price of the grain. But the rich man was a fool, because he saw possessions as being life, an end in themselves. He imagined that the more possessions are accumulated, the better the life and the more at ease in the world he would be. Contrary is so often the reality. Possessions bring worry and create divisions in the world, not peace. The parable gives us from the mouth of Jesus the verdict of God upon those who place their trust in wealth. Life is very fragile. It hangs by a thread. And Jesus is clear. There are far more important things to do in life than gather wealth and possessions together. For some, the gathering of wealth is an antidote to fear. They worry about the future and consider that the best way to prepare is to have a large financial cushion to fall back upon. Jesus uses the illustration of the death of the man as a warning that possessions are no basis for security and no protection whatsoever against the really important duty of being prepared to give account to God for how we have used our resources. The rich man thought that because he owned a lot of things, he was safe. The parable serves as a reminder that we have nothing. Even our very life can at any time be asked for by God. There's a contradiction. When life is seen as frail, we are tempted to think that the gathering of many possessions will help protect it. But Jesus says the contrary is true, because the possessions are frailer than life itself. Jesus tries to change the focus of his disciples and to stop them thinking about himself. If we want to be rich before God, then we must be a people who give to others, who think about the troubles of those who live with less, or perhaps who barely live at all. If our plan is to direct our effort towards getting things for ourselves, getting rich, then we will ultimately be poor towards God. None of this is easy, though. We all want to have financial security, enjoy the fruit of our labours, and there are hundreds of reasons which we can all think about of why we should not give away too much to others. However, today is a day in which we give thanks to God for everything that he has given to us. And it's a day to think about what we should do with what he has given to us, to consider our attitude and how our lives affect others. There's no doubt that it's impossible to justify things like corrupt business practices to exploit others. The Bible condemns those who use weighted scales to cheat. The same condemnation will be directed by Jesus towards Volkswagen for their defeat device, which put profits before the health of those who will suffer from pollution. Wealth was a factor also in the challenge that the Pope made on the Feast of St. Francis last week about climate change. Those who deny the existence of climate change must be very careful that this isn't used to justify not making changes to protect our planet and the millions of people who could die from flooding and other changing weather events. It's often said that the fault is not in the possession of things in themselves, but rather how tightly we cling to them, or how we use them, whether that be selfishly or wisely. But Jesus is clear. It is the focus of our lives that matter. That focus will determine how we use our possessions. We must place our trust on something much more reliable than possessions. The temptation is to think that the parable is only talking to the rich, and therefore is not about us ordinary folk. The fact is that people who have relatively little can be every bit as greedy as the rich and have the wrong focus in life, just as much as anybody else. Then there's the problem of thinking that we can just give everything up and have a life of complete frugality and presume that we've passed the test. But such life can also be just as indulgent and lead to a false sense of holiness, and can express itself in the criticism of others who do different. Remember, Jesus was never one to refuse a good celebration, behavior which caused him to be accused of being a drunken party god. These issues of resources, fair distribution, and our own possessions are incredibly serious, but equally challenging. So much so that Jesus spent a lot of time talking about it. Not the issues which we think are so important and preoccupy our church debates today. Our possessions and our money are things which can distract us from the serious business of being a disciple and living in ways which mark us out as followers of Jesus and members of God's kingdom. So let us pray that the Lord will help us to keep our focus on Him rather than possessions or money. It's easy to let worldly things distract us from following Jesus wholeheartedly. May we use what we've been given to serve our kingdom, the kingdom of God, by helping others and bringing God glory. In Jesus' name. We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified on Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures, he ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge our baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of death and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Father, Spirit, and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. We pray for the Church throughout the world. We ask that you will bring together all the different denominations of Christianity and all the different faiths throughout the world, that they may work together in this world for unity and peace, and be a shining example for the governments of the world of how to promote peace among different communities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this world in which we live, especially for those places where there is conflict and struck. We especially remember Israel, Gaza, the West Bank, and all those countries involved in that new conflict, that they may work together to find a peace, a lasting peace. We also remember Ukraine and all other places of conflict. Lord, may you bring your peace to those places. We pray for all those who are suffering. May you be with them as they comfort, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this act. We give thanks for the recent decision of Father John joining us here as our bishop. We pray for him, for his parish presently, and for ourselves. We pray that you may send your blessing upon his ministry as he comes to work with us here at St. Michael's. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who are suffering from any kind of need at this time. We especially remember all those in Israel, Gaza, the West Bank, and Ukraine. We remember our own sin. We especially remember Michael, Keith, Jonathan, Sidney, Chris, Reliever, Nadine, Liz Davis, Ian, Steve, Apple, Joe Fulane, Liz, Zoe, Toby, Spike of Liberty, and Pat, and those on our longer term sick. Be with them, O Lord, and bring them healing and strength. Lord, in your mercy, pray for all those who have gone before us on that path to eternal life. Especially remember with all those who have died recently and all those whose anniversary of death occurs this week. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
And their light perpetual shine upon them.
May they rest in peace. Lord, in your mercy. Now a few moments of silence. Let us bring before Almighty God our own personal prayers and petitions. We now join our prayers with those of St. Michael and all the saints, but chiefly with those of Mary, our mother, as together we say,
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee.
Blessed art thou among women,
and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God,
pray for us sinners now, and at the hour of our death.
Amen.
Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I give you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church. And graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of that. Pray, my brothers and sisters in Christ, that this sacrifice, which is both yours and mine, may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, to the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy Church.
Let us
bring forward the grain and the grape, our sandwich of bread and wine, to feed us with his body and his blood. Give him shed the life of the world. Let us feed on him by faith and thanksgiving. Through Christ our Lord. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of Behold Jesus, the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to this supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word.
Thank you to everybody who brought in donations today for our Harvest Festival. These will all be collected to go to our food bank and will go to those who are in most need. So thank you very, very much for this. And we offer these up in thanksgiving as we did at the offertory at the altar. So we've also got just one notice today, and that's actually just to say that the Winter Fair is going to be on Saturday the 25th of November at 11 o'clock, finishing at about 3. So if you're able to volunteer to run a stall, etc., we would be very, very grateful. We've got the cafe, the Dormitory Man, and various stores. If there's something you can do, please do let us know. Also, if you're able to bring in some of the goods that are required for a tombola or bric-a-brac, that would be also very gratefully received. We do know that we're going to have the induction shortly, but the confirmation of the final date is yet to be confirmed. But very, very soon, we will hopefully be able to say when our new vicar will be inducted and licensed here in Sidmouth. So please continue to keep him and our parish, his current parish, in your prayers. Any other notices, churchwardens? No, fantastic. If I can then please ask you to stand, bow your heads, and pray for God's blessing. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May God our Creator, who clothes the lilies and feeds the birds of the air, bestow on you his care and increase the harvest of your righteousness. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thank you.